I did something that I swore I would never do.
Again?
Yeah. I did something I swore I'd never do. It's not a bad thing. It's a good thing.
Oh, okay.
But I swore I'd never do it. I swore I would never do this again. This, look how big this teaching is. It's two-sided. Look on your notes. It's two-sided. There's probably 300 scriptures on here.
Nice.
So if you don't have like a real Bible, you're going to have a real hard time. If you're trying to do this with a phone or something, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough. We're not going to do the whole teaching. There's no way we can go through all this in one
show.
We would be here for 2 hours.
That's okay.
So,
and
you got somewhere else to go?
I've got some feedback on the mic. So, we are going to do the Torah portion by Echel. It comes from the verb like kahal, like a kehilat, a congregation. So kahal is basically, and he assembled, and he congregated Israel. So that's what the Torah portion means, and he yachel, he congregated. So we're going to go to Exodus 35. This is the last Torah portion of the Shabbat, of the book of Exodus. Last Torah portion of the book of Exodus. And I taught this when I first started Derech Olam back in 92, because I was astounded. I mean, I'd never heard this before. I was just reading the Torah portion, and I saw this, and I was already obsessed with Tavliot, with pictures. That everything in Judaism is a picture of heaven, of Yeshua, of God, of everything we need to know about spiritual things. That Judaism is a set of pictures of Yeshua, basically. I was already obsessed with it. And I found that there are 39 things listed here. And I started thinking, well, these things of the tabernacle are heaven. I mean, they're a picture of heaven. But what about the details? What are the staves, the tent pegs? They're about this big. It's called a yoted in Hebrew. What is that a picture of? Cords. What's that a picture of? The mercy seat. You think you know what that's a picture of? How about the poles that go through the Ark of the Covenant? How about the rings that the poles go through in the Ark of the Covenant? How about the pillars that the parochet, the veil, sits on? Do you know what that's a picture of? How about the veil itself? Do you know what that's a picture of? So I started thinking about this, and I'm like, I've never heard anybody teach on what the details mean. I've never heard anybody teach on the big, broad picture. This is a picture of heaven. Okay, good. But what is the picture? What are the details a picture of? So as I started studying this, I started finding more and more and more hidden things. So that's what I'm going to do, is I'm going to dig up a bunch of hidden stuff for you. All right, let's go to Exodus 35. And by the way, I put a header on my scriptures that says the 39 Tavliot. Because that's what this is to me. It's the 39 Tavliot. And by the way, there's not one verse in the Bible that says 39 anywhere. How many times was Yeshua whipped?
40 save one.
Wrong. Doesn't say that in the scriptures. Everybody says 40 save one or 39. Doesn't say that anywhere in the Bible. Nowhere.
Cool.
That is a myth.
And how many?
It doesn't say.
Oh.
He just whipped until he got tired, I guess. It never says that. It says in Deuteronomy 25 that a Jew, if they are righteously judged, righteously by a Jewish court, they're whipped 40 times. If they're whipped more than that, then they'll be degraded by their brothers and they'll be embarrassed, and we don't want that. But it was done with a three-stranded cord, like in Ecclesiastes. A three-stranded cord is not easily broken. And I've even drawn a picture of that three-stranded cord. And it's not like what you think. It's kind of like a belt that your parents used to beat you with. That's what it looked like. So it's a three-stranded cord, and nobody was ever hit more than 13 times. What's 13 times 3?
39.
That's where they got the myth that Yeshua was whipped 39 times. It is an absolute myth. The Romans beat him, and they had no restraint, and it was not a righteous judgment. Deuteronomy 25 is about a righteous judgment with a Jewish court on a Jewish person. All right, so Exodus 35, this is the only, and this doesn't say 39 either, but I found 39 things. All right, Let's read through it. Moshe Kahald assembled the congregation of the sons of Israel and said to them, these are the things that the Lord is charged to do. For 6 days we're going to do this. It talks about Shabbat. Don't kindle a fire in any of your dwellings on Shabbat. And then in verse 5, he says again, remember 3 weeks ago we had the Torah portion, Terumah, where you take up an offering. And he says it again, take from among you a terumah to the Lord, whoever is of a willing heart. So what he's doing is, it's hearkening back to what has already been said three Torah portions ago in terumah. It's just a restatement of this. So he said, remember when he said, take up a terumah to the Lord, whoever is of a willing heart, let him bring it as the Lord's contribution, or terumah, gold, silver, and bronze, blue, and purple, and scarlet. He lists all the shopping list of stuff. And then in verse 10, he starts listing the things that were made. And there are 39 of them. Let every skillful man among you come and make all that the Lord has charged. The Mishkan, its tent, its covering, its hooks, its boards, its bars, its pillars, its sockets or bases, the ark, its poles, the mercy seat. It's actually not mercy seat, it's actually covering, is what it says. The curtain of the screen, the table, the poles, the vessels, its vessels, the bread of the faces, the menorah for the light, its vessels, its lamps, the oil for the light, the altar of incense, its poles, and the anointing oil and the fragrant incense. That's for the regular anointing everything. And the incense that goes on the incense altar, and the screen for the doorway of the entrance of the Mishkan, and the altar of Olah with its bronze grating, its poles, its vessels, the basin and its stand, the hangings of the court, its pillars, its bases, and the screen for the gate of the court, the pegs of the Mishkan, and the pegs of the court, and their cords, the woven garments for ministering in the holy place, the holy garments for Aaron the Kohen, and the garments of his sons to minister as Kohanim. That's two garments. It's the garments of the woven garments for ministering in the holy place, and then the garments for Aaron the priest and his sons. Two different kinds of garments. All right, so I've listed every one of them, and we're going to go through as much as we can today, and we're going to have to break it up for next week. So the first one is the Mishkan, which is heaven. This is a little 45-foot-long portable model of heaven. And it's as close as human beings could get to heaven, or get to showing heaven, until the temple was built. Because the temple is exactly the same thing, only bigger. Twice as big. But it's the same thing. So the Mishkan is heaven. Let's go to Psalm 27:5. And connect to it. Psalm 27:5. For in the day of trouble, he will conceal me in his Mishkan. It's not talking about the physical Mishkan, it means heaven. He will conceal me in his Mishkan. In the secret place of his Ohel, he will hide me. He will lift me up on a rock. Now this is not talking about physical Mishkan. In the day of the Lord, in the day of trouble, we are going to be taken where? In the resurrection, where?
To heaven.
So it's talking about that in the day of trouble, in the day of the Lord, during the birth pains, what the church calls tribulation, the righteous are going to be resurrected to be taken to the Mishkan in heaven. And we'll see the real thing.
Does it say Mishkan or Sukkah?
Mishkan.
Does it say Ohel?
It says Ohel afterwards.
It says Sukkah.
Oh, maybe it's Sukkah, that second one. Maybe it wasn't. But the first one is Mishkan. Maybe it's still for the second.
Okay.
All right. Let's go to 76, Psalm 76, 2. Psalm 76, 2. Well, let's read the first verse. God is known in Judah. His name is great in Israel. What does that say? God is known where?
Judah.
God is known where?
Judah.
Judah is the Jews. God is known amongst the Jews. That's what this says. That's right. God is known in Judaism. God is known in Judaism, in Judah, in the Jews. This is mind-blowing for Christians. It's just mind-blowing. It doesn't say God is known in Christians. It says God is known in the Jews. His name is great in Israel, and his Mishkan is in Shalem. Now, where's Shalem? What is Shalem?
Peace.
Where is it, I said? What is it? Where is it?
It's in heaven.
What city is Shalem?
Jerusalem.
Jerusalem. Remember, Melchizedek, the king of Shalem, came from where? Came from heaven, it says.
From heaven.
It says he came from heaven. In Hebrews chapter 6, chapter 7, chapter 8. It says that Melchizedek came from heaven. And he was the king of Shalem. So he came from the upper Jerusalem down to the lower Jerusalem and met Abraham. So when it says Shalem here, it ain't talking about Jerusalem. What's it talking about?
Heaven.
And it's the Mishkan. His Mishkan is in heaven. His Mishkan is in heaven. His dwelling place also is in Sion. It's a different word, dwelling place, a different word. We're looking for Mishkan. His Mishkan is in heaven. So what did God do? He said, hey Jews, make a little model of where I live. How big? About 45 feet. That's where you live. Well, it's a little bigger than that, but just make a little model. Okay. And so that's what they were doing. They were building a model of where God lives. A little shoebox with a cube on the end. All right. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews 8. The main point in what has been said is this. We have a high priest who has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. Where's the throne?
In the heavens.
Where's the throne?
In the heavens.
In the heavens. A minister in the Mishkan. And in the true Mishkan, which the Lord pitched, not man. So somehow, I mean, remember, this is all metaphorical. This is not real. Everything that God gave us is metaphor. God pitched a Mishkan in heaven. He pitched a tent in heaven. He erected, built, pitched his dwelling place in heaven. And remember, this is just metaphorical. And so he told the Jews, pitch a Mishkan on earth. Because that's what I did in heaven. You want to see where I live? Build it. And you'll see where I live. Let's go to Revelation chapter 7. Verse 15. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and they serve him day and night in his, what is your say? What is your say?
Temple.
Temple? In his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his Mishkan over them. So this has both words, temple and sanctuary. And they're the same thing. When I told you that they built the Mishkan, and then they expanded it by 200%, and they built the temple, why? Because God lives in a Mishkan temple. What does he live in? He lives in a Mishkan. No one lives in a temple. No one lives in a Mishkan. No one lives in a temple. So they made both because that's where he lives. And if you're going to make a model of where he lives, you've got to make both. Because they are in his temple and he who sits on his throne will spread his Mishkan over them. All right, let's go to chapter 13, verse 6. This is talking about the false Messiah. He opened his mouth in blasphemies against God to blaspheme his name and his Mishkan. Now look at this. His Mishkan, that is those who dwell in heaven. So, what is the Mishkan made out of?
People.
Those who dwell in heaven. It's not just talking about people, it's talking about angels too. So, the actual Mishkan itself is the spirits.
Oh, that's cool.
Isn't that cool?
Yeah, it really
is. Is the spirits in which God dwells.
Because we're one of the 39 parts.
Yes,
we are. We're serving a certain capacity.
Hold on, I gotta get it.
Yeah. That's cool.
Daniel said we're one of the 39 parts. No, we're a bunch of the 39 parts. Yeah. So if you look at all the 39 bits and pieces, the parts, that's us too. Because that's God cool. said, Ve'asu mi mikdash v'shachanti betocham. Build me a sanctuary that I might what?
Dwell in them.
Dwell in them. Build me the model so I may dwell in them. Build me a model so I can dwell in them.
That's real cool.
So here, heaven is shown to be made out of the people. We are the Mishkan and the temple, sort of, where God dwells.
Like living stones.
Exactly. Made the temple. Right. Exactly right. Look at chapter 15, verse 5. After these things I looked, and the temple, this is weird, the temple of the Mishkan was open. How about that? The temple of the tabernacle of testimony. The temple of the tabernacle. Now it puts both together. In case you didn't get it the first 10 times.
What verse is that?
That's verse 5. 15:5. Okay. After these things I looked, and the temple of the Mishkan. So in order to have the right picture, you've got to picture both a traveling tent thing and a permanent stone made thing. You've got to picture both in order to understand where God dwells. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Now I want to bring us back to the primary thing we're looking at. We're looking at this. V'asu mi mikdash v'shachanti betocham.
Make for me
a sanctuary that I may dwell in them. God is known in Judah. His dwelling place is in Israel. Well, if that's true, then that means that what Yeshua said is true when he said, salvation is of the Jews.
Of course.
Salvation, it doesn't just mean because Jesus was a Jew.
No.
It doesn't mean that. It means salvation comes because of the Jews. Why? God is known in Judah.
Right.
If you want to go to where God is, you got to go there. Because that's where the Mishkan is, that's where the tabernacle is, that's where the temple is, that's where all the vessels and all these 39 Tavniot that we're going to look at, it dwells in Judaism. Nowhere else on the planet. So if you want God to dwell in you, I mean, he already lives in there, but if you wanted to really dwell in there, like have a presence in there and do stuff in there, you got to go to this. You got to go to the Mishkan, you got to go to Judaism. All right, the second one is the Ohel. Say Ohel.
Ohel.
It's not Ohel, it's Ohel.
Ohel.
Ohel. It means tent. Now, there's four coverings.
Yeah, I get that one.
On the Mishkan, on the traveling Mishkan, the tabernacle. There's the Mishkan. On the inside is the Mishkan. Covering that is the Ohel, the tent. Covering that is the Mikseh Ohel, the tent's covering. And over that is the Mikseh, the covering. How many coverings are there?
Four.
Nope.
Seven.
Nope. I'll do it again. The tabernacle,
three.
Mishkan is the first one. Second one is the Ohel, the tent. Third one is the Mikseh Ohel, the tent's covering. Fourth one is the Mikseh, the covering. How many coverings are there?
Two.
Two. There's four tents.
But two Mikseh.
Material things.
Two
but there's
called,
two that are called Mikseh, or covering.
Right.
Two that are called covering. Now we're looking at the second one, the second layer, which is the Ohel, the tent. This is a picture of two things. It's a picture of heaven, like we saw, but it's also a picture of our human body. This is a tent.
Yeah.
All right, let's go to Psalm 15. Psalm 15. O Lord, who can abide or dwell in your ohel? Who may dwell on your holy hill? Or where is this holy hill?
Jerusalem?
Nope. Shalem. Where is this holy hill?
In heaven.
In heaven. There's also one on earth that mirrors it, but his holy hill is in heaven. So he says, Lord, who can dwell in your ohel? So there, if it's on the holy hill in heaven, where's the ohel?
In heaven.
It is heaven. It is heaven.
The tent is
heaven, just like the Mishkan is heaven. And then he says, who can do that? Who can go up there? He who walks with integrity and works righteousness and speaks truth in his heart, doesn't slander with his tongue, does not do evil to his neighbor, doesn't take up a reproach against his friend. That's the kind of people that will be dwelling in heaven and making up heaven, being part of heaven. All right, let's go to verse 27. What?
Chapter 27.
27, thank you. Chapter 27, 1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the defense of my life. Whom shall I dread? Why do I have this verse? When he goes to words, came upon me to devour me, my enemies is coming for me.
Verse 5.
Verse 5, thank you. Bound to be a mistake here. Verse 5. For in the day of trouble, he will conceal me. There it is again. We read this earlier in a different verse. In the day of trouble, when's the day of trouble?
The day of the Lord.
When's the day of trouble?
The first 7 years.
Day of the Lord, the birth pangs of the day of the Lord. He will conceal me in his Mishkan, in the secret place of his Ohel. He will hide me. Well, that is the same verse.
It says what?
It is.
Mine says?
No, check the Hebrew. It says Sukkah.
Mine says Ohel.
It's best, well, at the first, the word says,
hide me in his Sukkah, conceal me in the shelter of his tent.
The third word is Sukkah in the Hebrew. And then the last word.
Okay, hold on, you guys are confusing me. He will conceal me in his Mishkan. It says Mishkan, yes?
Mine says Sukkah.
Mine says Sukkah.
Okay.
Are y'all reading Hebrew?
I'm reading Hebrew.
What do you say?
Okay, all right. So where it says tabernacle, it's Sukkah.
That's the same.
Where it says so I shouldn't have quoted that verse for the Mishkan. In the secret place of his Ohel. It does say Ohel.
Yes. That's mine.
All right. So it does say Ohel, but it says Sukkah instead of Mishkan. So I was wrong in the Mishkan. Okay, so the Ohel is in heaven. All right, let's go to 52.5.
Yeah.
52.5. God will break you down forever. That's lovely.
Oh, joy.
Why do I have that?
Again?
Again? Why do I have this verse? 52.5. 52.5.
Verse 7.
God will break you down forever. He'll snatch you up and tear you away from the tent. Oh, that's why. Okay. God will break you down forever. He will snatch you up and tear you away from your tent and uproot you from the land of the living. If you're uprooted from the land of the living, you're what?
Dead.
Not in the living. You're
if you're uprooted from the land of the living, you're dead. And he says, I'm going to rip you out of your tent. So what's the tent in this verse?
Our skin,
the human body. It's the human body. It's a metaphor for the body. He's telling the evil people,
here it's Ohel.
You know, I'm going to rip you right out of your body. You're going to be taken away from the land of the living. You're going to die. So he's talking to evil people. Actually, he's talking to Doeg the Edomite. Doeg the Edomite, who killed a bunch of priests right in front of David.
David killed them, right?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, David killed Doeg. Yeah.
Good.
Anyway, so he says, I'm going to rip you right out of your body. So here, you know, it's not just in the New Testament where our bodies are called tents. It's also in the Old Testament. This is one of them.
That's where Paul got the idea.
Of course, that's where Paul got the idea. Right. All right. 104. Thank you. 104.2. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a cloak, stretching out heaven like a curtain. He lays the beams of his upper chambers in the waters. This is weird. It's very hard to understand this because it's all metaphor. And it's metaphor on top of metaphor on top of metaphor on top of metaphor. You're clothed with splendor and majesty, that's obvious. Covering yourself with light, like a tent, like a garment.
Yeah.
Stretching out heaven like a curtain, or like a tent curtain. Stretching out heaven like a tent curtain. He lays the beams of his upper chamber. In the temple, beams, there were cedar beams that were in the upper chamber. Now the upper chamber was a room above the Holy of Holies. And that's what he's describing. He's describing the Holy of Holies, and then the room above the Holy of Holies, and the beams that are on top in between those two rooms. That was where a little boy who was a newborn was hidden for 7 years before he was made king and came out and they killed Athaliah. Athaliah was worse than Jezebel. She tried to destroy all the kings of Judah. Well, they found one little newborn baby. And they got this baby, the son of Judah, and they hid him in that upper chamber above the Holy of Holies. Hmm. And so the seed was hidden, and so Messiah could later come. Had she succeeded in killing this kid, this little boy, Yoav, that would have been the end.
Yoav?
Messiah would never have come.
Wow.
So it's talking about the layers of heaven, metaphorically.
So if there's layers, there's seven heavens, levels of where we end up going to. And
there's levels
out.
Of heaven, yeah.
Exactly.
Let's just keep it at that.
Yeah.
There's levels yeah. of heaven, yeah. yeah.
And levels of reward, I suppose, also.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's so crazy, that chapter.
Isn't that weird?
104?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. Don't read farther, because we're going to come back to it for another picture. Let's go to, where are we? Isaiah 33. Isaiah 33, verse 20. Look upon Zion, the city of your Moedim. Your eyes will see Jerusalem, an undisturbed habitation, an ohel, which shall not be folded up. The whole city, Jerusalem, is described as an ohel. Why? Is it talking about Jerusalem above or Jerusalem below?
I think this one's below.
Yeah. Is it talking about Jerusalem above or Jerusalem below? Yes.
Oh.
yeah.
That's the answer. It's talking about both because the one below reflects the one above. Right?
Sure.
You got same picture above and below. And so the metaphor is that because heaven is an ohel, a tent, Jerusalem below is a tent, an ohel. All right, let's go to 38, 12. Like a shepherd's ohel, my dwelling is pulled up and removed from me. What's he talking about here? Can you tell?
Wait,
let's read verse 11. No, let's read verse 10. This is Hezekiah. He says, in the middle of my life, I am to enter the gates of hell. I am to be deprived of the rest of my years. I said, I will not see the Lord in the land of the living. I will look on man no more among the inhabitants of the world. Like a shepherd's tent, my dwelling is pulled up, removed from me. What's the shepherd's tent?
His body.
His body. This is another one talking about his human, the yeah. human body. All right, let's go to chapter 40, verse 22. It is he, God, who sits on the circle of the earth, above the circle of the earth. And its inhabitants are like grasshoppers who stretch out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. I'm going to say something that you're not going to understand at all, but I'm going to say it anyway. I'll get it on the video. Nothing is made out of something. The fabric, there is a fabric of space. Einstein discovered this. That space is not air, it's not nothing. It's made out of something. It's like fabric. Gravity is like It's like a like something sitting on a fabric, and it bends, literally bends the fabric of space. And he proved it. It took him 15 years, but he proved it. And they could actually see light bending from gravity by the forces of gravity.
Wow.
If that's true, that there's a fabric of space, then this sort of makes sense.
Yeah,
that God stretched out heaven like curtains of oka, like fabric, that he actually worked with it. Now, I don't know what that means. I mean, not even close. I'm not even smart for my age. But I know that it's a, I know that it's true. If you want to go find out what that means, go find out what it means. But fabric, the ohel is a fabric. And space, heaven, is something that's visceral. It's something that's real. In the Greek world, heaven is not real. It's everything is symmetrical. Everything is peaceful. And there's nothing. It's just a lack of everything. Like Buddhism, you look for nirvana, where there's just a lack of everything. Well, that's not how it is in Judaism. Judaism is visceral, it's real. It's describable in metaphors. So that I like this verse for that reason. Okay, where are we? Isaiah 38:12. All right, 40, verse 22 we just did. Now let's go to 2 Corinthians 5. The biggest difference between Judaism and normative Christianity, well, let me say this. The biggest difference between biblical Judaism and normative Christianity is what I just said. Visceral. Visceral. In normative Christianity, everything's based on the brain. It's very ethereal. You can't touch it. There's nothing to touch. In Judaism, it's all based on metaphors, which is something physical. This is a metaphor for something spiritual. Well, if you don't have something physical, you can't understand it. We're like children. We got to have something to touch, feel, smell, taste. We got to get visceral with it in order to understand. Well, that's what God. That's why God created Judaism. It is a visceral set of pictures and metaphors to teach us about God. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. This is about the human body. We know that if this earthly ohel, which is our house, our bait, is torn down. So he's speaking metaphorically. He doesn't say if we're killed. No. He doesn't say if we die. He says if the house is torn down. If the ohel of our house is torn down. We have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Where is the ohel?
In the heavens.
Where is our ohel?
Up there.
Here.
Where is our ohel?
It's up there too. Oh, it's here.
It's right here. But we're going to get another covering. I don't know. He doesn't call it an ohel here.
No.
He doesn't call our resurrected body an ohel, does he? Does he?
He calls it bazaar.
What does he call it here? He just calls it a house.
Yeah.
A bait.
A bait.
So he doesn't call it an ohel. He calls it a bait. The one in heaven. The one on earth, this, is an ohel. Why?
Oh.
It's fabric. You can mess with it.
Well, you said something earlier. You said, remember the temporary and the founded building.
Yes. God's house is, the metaphor is fabric, and then what was the temple made out of? What was the temple made out of?
Fabric.
The temple. What was the temple made out of?
Stones.
Stones.
Permanent.
Permanent. So that's what he's saying here. He's saying, right now we live in
a traveling tent,
an ohel. But when we get our building from God, our resurrected body, it's more comparative to a temple, to a stone house, than fabric. That's all he's saying.
That's good.
Yeah. For indeed, in this we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven. Inasmuch as we, having put it on, in other words, we're going to die and get a new body. We're not naked. For indeed, while we are in this ohel, we groan, being burdened, because we don't want to be unclothed, but we want to get clothing in order that what is mortal can be swallowed up by eternal life. So, this is a an Ohel. God's house is an Ohel. We are part of that Ohel. It's made out of us and angels. Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
I just think that's so strange. All right, now, you have the Mishkan, then you have the Ohel. What's next?
Mikseh Ohel.
Good. Mikseh Ohel. What's on top of that?
It's the Mikseh.
Mikseh. Do it again. You have the Mishkan.
Mishkan.
On top of that is what?
Ohel.
The Ohel. On top of that is what?
Mikseh
Ohel. The Mikseh Ohel. The Ohel's covering. And on top of that?
Mikseh.
Mikseh. Covering. How many coverings are there?
Two.
Now he's going to say that as one tavniot, as one tavnit, as one picture. The next one is just, he just says, covering. Mikseh. Mikseh. Now it comes from the word for throne. Kiseh, or chair. Why would the word for chair be covering?
Because he sits in heaven.
Yeah, you're thinking ethereal. Think physically.
Okay.
Why would the word in Hebrew for chair be the same word for covering?
Because he sits on
it. That makes sense.
Sits on it.
You're sitting down. It's kind of like engulfed in it.
Sort of, you're on the right track. Here's why. A throne has a covering.
Oh.
It's pretty simple. Any throne has a kiseh, a covering. And it literally means to conceal. To conceal. This is what I like talking about. When the new moon comes, it's concealed. It's black. It's right. Dark. You can't see it. All you can see is like a little haze around it. You're seeing the dark side of the moon. It's called Kiseh, the Kiseh moon.
Oh, wow.
It's called the covered moon. In fact, Rosh Hashanah, which is a new moon, is called Yom HaKiseh, the day of concealment, the day of throne, the day of chair. And it's a new moon. Why? Because God, and I hate this and I love it about God, God hides himself.
All the time.
He hides himself. And he's so, what's the word, mischievous about things. And I hate it. I wish he'd just come right out and say, here's what I want, and here's what is going on, and here's what I want you to do, and here's what I'm doing, and here's what I'm thinking. Why doesn't he just come out and tell us? Because we have to go hunt for him.
He wants us to work for it.
He wants us to work for it. Exactly right. He wants us to hunt for him like treasure. He wants us to dig and hunt for his secrets like treasure. So on purpose, he hides them. Mm-hmm. And then he goes, ha, 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 you can't find me. And he teases us and taunts us. Yeah. And says, well, do you want to know me or not? Mm-hmm. And all the Gentile world just goes,
can you hide and seek?
Not really. Too much work. And the Jews, for some weird reason, we go, yeah, I do. I don't know why I do, but I do. And we go hunting on this ridiculous, lifelong, ridiculous. I mean, it is ridiculous. It makes no logical sense whatsoever for us to be obsessed with tents and poles and tent pegs and ropes and weird-looking angel things with calf legs. Who cares? But that's what Jews are obsessed with. Because it's a ridiculous search we go on to find all these hidden things about God. And he does it on purpose. Don't think he doesn't. He does. Yeshua said it. If you want to find God, you have to dig for him as treasure. Yes?
So it's like looking for the octocomen.
Yes, right. It's exactly like looking for the octocomen at Passover.
Totally.
We hide it. We purposely hide it. We're mischievous about it. Make the kids hide their eyes. And we go hide it. And we're like, we ain't going to get my money.
Right.
I'm going to hide it real good. And then some curious kid always finds it. You got to cough up the devil. Well, that's how God is. He makes us hunt. This thing that we're going to look at right now, the two coverings, I don't understand this. I read the words. I get it. I get the picture in my head, but I don't understand it. So maybe you'll get more revelation about it than I have, but I love looking at the words. The Mikseh is God's concealing concealing presence. It's not the Holy Spirit showed up and it feels so good. It's the Holy Spirit showed up and I can't see him. He's concealed. I'm going to go find him. I'm going to go dig and find him. So it sounds contradictory, but this is how it works. So let's go to 1 Kings chapter 22. I mean, I like having a good time as much as anybody else. I love, like, when we're worshiping, and you're in a big church, and there's 450,000 people worshiping together, and the Holy Spirit falls, and everybody feels it. That's not God's concealing presence.
No.
It's not. That's just God having fun with us.
Yeah, what verse? 22:10. First King.
What did I say? 1 Kings 22. Oh, I love this.
You have 10 also.
Yeah, let's read. We got 10.
22:10.
22:10. Okay. Well, let me tell you what's going on here. Two kings, King of Judah and the King of Israel, have gone to battle together. They're not supposed to. God hates the King of Israel. Hates him. Because he hates God. The King of Judah is a good guy. He loves God. God loves him. They got a relationship. But there's intermarriage between the two families. And so the King of Judah, like an idiot, he says, okay, I'll go to battle with you. And the King of Judah and the King of Israel are on their thrones, on their kisei, their kiseot, their thrones. And all 450 prophets are all prophesying, go up and you'll win the battle. And the King of Israel says, no, the King of Judah says, isn't there one guy who can tell me what Yahweh is saying? And the King of Israel says, well, there's one guy. His name's Micaiahu. He's an idiot. I hate the guy. He never says anything good. And the King of Judah says, no, no, don't talk like that. Bring him up. Let's see what he has to say. And so Micaiahu, he says, go up, go and succeed. And the King of Judah says, how many times do I have to tell you, no, the King of Israel says, how many times do I have to tell you, don't lie to me. Tell me what Yahweh is saying. The King of Israel says this, who hates Yahweh. Hmm. And he says, how many times do I have to tell you, tell me the truth? And so Micaiah says this, let's go to verse 10. Now the King of Israel and Jehoshaphat, King of Judah, were sitting each on his throne, arrayed in their robes at the threshing floor of the entrance of the gate of Shomron. All the prophets were prophesying. Let's go down to verse 15. When he came to the king said to Micaiahu, shall we go to Ramoth Gilead? He said, yeah, go up, go up. Look at verse 17. He says, you know, how many times I can tell you? Tell me nothing but what Yahweh says. So he said, I saw all Israel scattered on the mountains like sheep which have no shepherd. And Yahweh said, these have no master. Let each of them return to his house in peace.
Wow.
Let each of them return to his house. So this guy, Micaiahu, he's able to discover what's going on. He can see it. He can see what's going on in heaven. Verse 19, Micaiahu said, therefore, hear the word of the Lord. I saw Yahweh sitting on his kisei, on his throne, and all the host of heaven standing by him on his right and his left. And Yahweh said, who was going to go up and entice Ahab to go die? And so a spirit came forward and said, hey, I got an idea. Let's try this. And Yahweh says, hey, good idea. Go do it. And so that spirit went into the mouth of all those 450 prophets. And so exactly what God planned happened. The King of Israel went up. And he got shot. Some random arrow went into a chink of his armor between his arm and his chest, right in his lung, and killed him. So Micaiahu saw the throne of God. What is throne in Hebrew?
Kisei.
Kisei. What does it mean?
Concealment.
Concealment. Covering. This is the throne of God. It is a covering, concealed thing. I can't hear you. Say it louder.
Use your outside voice.
The period, like it used to be said that the he said would be like the period.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You're saying the period. Yes. 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 I don't want to go into that right now, but yes, that's the right picture. Psalm 9, verse 4. There are secrets to find out about God, and He does not share them easily. Psalm 9, verse 4. For you have maintained my just cause, and you sit on the kised, on the concealed throne, judging righteously. Verse 7. But Yahweh abides forever. He has established His throne for judgment. He will judge the world in righteousness. So this covering is His throne. But you can't picture like a throne like in Europe. You've got to picture a throne that has a cap over it, an umbrella type thing over it. It's very different. And in fact, it's got a circular back. When Solomon built the throne for Judah, he built it with seven steps, which is a picture of the 6 days of man, and then the seventh day, God's day, and on the top of that is a throne. And it says it's made on ivory, which means it's a great white throne, and it has a round back. And then it has a covering. All right, let's look at Psalm 97. Verse 1. The Lord reigns, let the earth rejoice, let the many islands be glad. Now here we go. Here's where I start getting confused. Clouds and thick darkness surround Him. That's the kised. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of His kised. So clouds and thick darkness. What do clouds and thick darkness do to our visibility? They conceal it. They take it away. So this covering thing in heaven is like clouds. It's like thick darkness. It's like a kisei, like fabric over a throne. It's like a whole bunch of stuff. But whatever it is, it conceals. Whatever it's made out of or described by, it conceals. Chapter 104. Verse 2, 1 and 2. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all, O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. I don't know what that means. It's not metaphor. I mean, it is a metaphor, but it's not poetic. It's not, thou art clothed in splendor and majesty. It means that there's some fabric that is splendor and some fabric that is majesty clothing God. It's a metaphor. But you got to picture something physical to understand this. Yes?
So clouds and darkness surround Him, uh-huh. But inside that, those clouds and darkness is light.
Yes.
Yes.
Let me get that on the tape. Clouds and darkness surround Him, but inside that darkness is light. What was the Mishkan? The Mishkan is a covering over it, covering over it, covering over it, covering, and inside what do you have? A menorah of light. And then the Holy of Holies, where God's fireball of His face shows up. So yes, of course. All right, let's do 105, chapter 105, verse 39. He spread a cloud for a mikseh, for a covering, and fire to illumine by night. Now it's talking about when the Jews left Egypt and they would follow the presence of God, which showed up like a tornado of fire, and then a tornado of fire at night, and then during the day it was a pillar, like a pillar made out of what?
Smoke.
Cloud or smoke. Yes? That's the presence of God. It is a concealing thing. When the Jews came out of Egypt and Egypt was behind the Jews, and they're hemmed in. They got the Red Sea in front of them. They got mountains to the side, and they got Egypt behind. What did God do? He went around between them. And it says he concealed Pharaoh from being able to see Israel. The presence of God is a concealing thing. It's not a revealing thing. God's presence is not made for revealing, for revelation. It's made for concealment. I know that is disturbing, and I know it's weird, and I know it's upside down and backwards from what we usually think. But I want to say it again. God's presence, his heavy presence, was not made for revelation. That's another part of God. This picture is created for concealment. Yes.
When they were coming out of Egypt, the darkness was over the Egyptians, and the other side of that pillar was light.
That's right. On one side of the pillar was darkness over Egypt, and on the other side was bright light for the Jews. That's exactly right. Yeah. So it was created specifically for concealment. Let's go to Isaiah 4.
Much like today.
Yeah. Okay. Isaiah 4. All we're really doing today, maybe next week, probably next week, all we're really doing is I'm trying to get you to think differently. That's all I'm doing. I'm trying to build some vocabulary so that you can start, visual vocabulary, so you can start seeing things. When you read the Bible, you'll see things more clearly, more viscerally. That's what I'm after. Not so fuzzy and ethereal.
Yeah.
All right, Isaiah 4.
Learn to read Hebrew and it gets very clear.
That's right. You learn to read Hebrew and it gets even clearer. When the Lord has washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion and purged the bloodshed of Jerusalem from her midst, by the spirit of judgment and the spirit of burning. Then, you got to read this carefully, the Lord will create over the whole area of Mount Zion. Now this is talking about physical Mount Zion in the day of the Lord. And over her assemblies, a cloud. Smoke. Brightness of a flaming fire. For over all the kavod, glory, will be a chuppah, a canopy. And there will be a sukkah to give shade from the heat by day, and refuge and protection from the storm and the rain. Now you could put refuge and protection together, some rabbis do, which gives us seven coverings. I don't want to go into that whole thing, but I'm going to say this. The tabernacle, how many coverings does it have?
Seven.
No. How many coverings does it have?
Two.
Coverings, two. But it's the same picture. You've got Mishkan, you've got Ohel, Mikseh Ohel, Ohel. It's covering on top of covering on top of covering on top of covering. And that's what God wants. He wants concealment. He wants hidden. He wants secrets. He wants mysteries. Because that's what surrounds him. I don't know why, but that's how it is.
Well, I think it's just like we are. We don't sit there. We have a public face. We have a private face. You know, we have outer circles and inner circles in our life. We don't tell everybody everything.
Is this a fire?
Ezekiel chapter 1.
Is this fire and cloud on the
kavod? Yes. I just listed seven nouns in Hebrew that created God's covering, and one of them was kavod, glory. It's one of them. It came about in the 13th year, on the 5th day of the 4th month, that I was by the river Chebar. The heavens were open. I saw visions of God. I saw visions of God. I saw visions of God. Not I saw visions of stuff. I saw visions of God. Do you understand how weird that is?
Visions plural.
Visions of God. Not visions of things. Visions of God. Verse 4. Behold, a storm wind was coming from the north, a great cloud, with fire flashing forth continually, and a bright light around it. And it emits something like glowing metal in the midst of the fire. Within it, there were figures resembling four. So we got coverings. We got layers, like a core, and then a layer, and then another layer, and then another layer. And you're going to see some more layers. Go to verse 22. Over the heads of the living beings, there was something like an expanse. An expanse. I don't know what that is. It's just like a big space. Like the awesome gleam of crystal extended over their heads. It's another layer. And under the expanse, their wings were stretched out straight. Go to verse 26. Above the expanse, here's another layer. Above the expanse that was over their heads, there was something resembling a throne, like lapis lazuli in appearance. And on that which resembled a throne, high up, was a figure of appearance of a human, a man. Then I noticed from the appearance of his loins a number, blah, 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 blah. Verse 28. As the appearance of a rainbow in the clouds on a rainy day, that's what the appearance of the surrounding radiance looked like. So he has described at least five layers. And we haven't looked at them very carefully, but we have seen layers. You got a core, and you got a layer around it, another layer, another layer, another layer, and it's traveling, it's moving. That is the covering, the mikse of God, the concealment of God. How did it start out? What did Ezekiel see? What did he see?
A storm.
Visions of God. Visions of God. In other words, his eyes were opened and he saw concealment. He saw a whole bunch of stuff, but ultimately what he saw was layers and layers and layers and layers of stuff that you really can't see. Look at chapter 10. Ezekiel 10. I looked and behold in the expanse, there's the expanse again, that was over the heads of the cherubim, something like a sapphire stone, resembling a throne. Like a throne. He doesn't say it's a throne, he says it's something like a throne. And he keeps saying this. I saw something like a rainbow, right. Something like lapis lazuli, something like a throne, something like a man, something like a lion, something like a bull, something like an eagle.
Which verse are you on?
I mean, chapter 10, 1 and 2. So, it's all metaphor. It's all metaphor. It's the best he can do. And even in that, all he's seeing is concealment. Okay. Let's go to... That's good for that. All right, so that's the coverings. How many coverings are there?
Four, two.
How many coverings are there?
Two.
How many layers are there?
Four.
So you got the mikse, the ohel, the mikse, ohel, the mikse. And those are heaven. And they're made out of something. I don't know what. Something. Now, on the inside of that mishkan, and ohel, and mikse, ohel, and mikse, were boards. There was a structure that the curtains of the tent were over. And then remember we did that study on shittim wood.
Yeah.
And the boards, those huge boards. Now we're going to look at the boards, yes.
There's number four is skipped, so are we missing one in the...
It's the just the numeration.
Or, are we missing something?
It could be, yeah.
Let's go back.
Three to five.
Let's go back to Exodus. 35.
Oh, to see which one we missed.
I think I know what it is.
Backspace.
Thank you for pointing that out, Nina. There's a 35. What is going on? There's going to attack Mishkan. Covering. Oh, the hooks. I dropped out the hooks. Thank you. Number three is the hooks. The hooks, the rabbis say...
Oh, so the covering should be four?
Yeah, covering is four.
Okay.
Right? Is that right? No, I'm sorry. Hooks is four. Covering is three, hooks is four. So the hooks are, there was 50 of them on one side of a set of curtains, and 50 of them on another side of the curtains. And the rabbis say this, when you're in the Mishkan and you look up and you see the light hitting those hooks, what do you think it would look like?
Stars.
Right. That's what it is. It's pictures of stars.
Yovel. It has to do with a Yovel, similar.
The stars, there's 50 on one side, 50 on the other. How many is that?
100.
That's one day.
25 and 24.
One day. One day.
Oh, the Mahdi.
There's 50 on one side, 50 on the other. It's one day. It's 100. So it's a picture of one day, the day of the Lord. And you look up, and you see those things, you know, the light from the menorah twinkling on them. And the rabbis say, it looks like stars. It is stars. How many of them are there?
50 on each side.
How many of them are there total?
100.
There's 100. There's 100 stars. Now, I didn't put it, I can't believe I dropped this out. But it says in Philippians, I believe it's chapter 2, it says this. It says that we are stars twinkling in the night among the blackness of this world.
Really?
So this is a picture of us being in the holy place. We are stars in the holy place. So again, the Mishkan is made out of us. Make sense?
Interesting.
I don't have it here. I had it written on my notes, and then when I transferred them to the computer, I dropped that out. I'm sorry. All right, chapter number 5 is the boards. Let's go to 1 Kings 22. We just read this. This is about Mikayahu. We don't even have to read it. I'll just re-quote it. When Mikayahu went to prophesy to the two kings, he said, "I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, what was to his right and to his left." Okay, you don't remember. Let's do it then. 1 Kings 22. I thought you remembered. Sorry, Charlie. Verse 19. Mikayahu said, "Therefore, hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and all the host of heaven standing on his right and on his left." The host of heaven. Is that people? Is it angels? Is it seraphim? Is it cherubim? What is it?
All of them.
Yes, it's all of that. And that's what makes heaven. Heaven is made out of those erect spirits. Israel is called Yashar 4 times in Deuteronomy. Yashar. Yashar means upright or erect. He's called, or she's called, Yeshurun, the upright one. Why? Because we're standing up straight. We're part of the tabernacle of God's dwelling. Nobody else on the planet is until they join that rows and rows of the host of heaven through Yeshua. Okay. Revelation chapter 4. This is a description of that. Just like Mikayahu saw it, so did John. And he described it a little bit differently, but pretty close to the same. 4:4. This is during the day of the Lord. Verse 3. He was sitting, and he who was sitting was like a jasper stone, and a sardis in appearance. There was a rainbow around the throne, that's the covering, and like it was kind of like an emerald in appearance. And around the throne were 24 thrones, and on those thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white garments and golden crowns on their heads. So here we got a little more detail. Now we got rows and rows and rows of the host of heaven, and we got 24 thrones. So you got that too. All right, let's go to chapter 5, verse 11. And the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders. There's the elders on their thrones. And the four living creatures, the chayot, say chayot.
Chayot.
It's the word chay, which means life, and it just means living things. It's the ones with the four heads that we're going to talk about in a few minutes. And the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God. Who fell on their faces and worshiped God? The angels, the elders, and the chayot. And they all fell down. This is the host of heaven. All the armies, the host, the armies of heaven. And this is the boards. These are pictured by the boards. Chapter 7, verse 11. We just read that.
No. We read 5:11. Now we're 7:11.
Isn't that weird? You know what? I just read 7:11.
Well, it's pretty much the same thing.
Isn't that a trick?
It's the exact same thing.
I read 7:11. Read 5:11.
Yeah.
And I looked and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne and the chayot and the zekanim, the elders, and the number of them was myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands. Yeah, it sounds almost exactly the same. So this is the host of heaven. Yeah. These are pictured by what? These
boards.
Are pictured by what?
Boards.
By what?
The boards in the tabernacle.
They're pictured by the boards. Okay, now, in those boards, you had 100 of them. In those, actually 96. 96 of them. Two sides, north and south, and then the west. You had 96 boards. Through those boards were five bars. There were four on the outside of the tabernacle, and one, I don't know what this means, that went all the way through and around, it says in the Torah. It says, and the bar that went all the way through.
So they weren't linked?
Well, this one must have been.
I don't know.
I mean, it's got four corners. You can't, it's not easy.
Three corners. The front has
so it's a U-shape.
It's a U-shape. Yeah.
So it's U-shape. Well, U-shape, you can make something that's 45 feet long and stab it.
Hold on. I already answered. I don't know. It says in Hebrew.
I realize you said I don't know. That's why I'm suggesting it's a U-shaped pin, like a staple, but big.
Like a U-pole.
45 feet long.
Yeah. Then you stab
15 feet long, and another 45 feet long.
It's a big U.
And it's one piece.
Right. That's what I'm saying. It's a staple.
It goes through the middle of the horn.
So you stab it when you push it through.
But then it won't go through the back side.
But the back side can still be notched to where
it's not notched.
Well, I don't
know. It goes all the way through.
It goes through.
Wow. I mean, that's the best I can come up with. I know what you
just don't need you to come up with anything. I need you to try to not figure it out. This is hard. Because we want to figure it out. I'm telling you what the Hebrew says.
That's true.
It says, and the bar that went all the way through the boards. Now the rabbis say it was one bar that went all the way through the boards. Not and true. They would put it in and it would just extend all the way through the bar. It would just go.
So another
make
miracle.
That curve. Make
it
that
was
the
whole
another miracle.
Right.
And it's covered in gold.
Yeah.
Inexplicable.
Inexplicable. Absolutely inexplicable. Obviously it's a picture. Obviously it's a metaphor.
What, the perimeter or the camp?
So listen, you got millions of angels and elders and holy ones, believers, and chayot, and they're all doing the same thing at the same time. What is that bar?
The spirit.
Right. See, if you don't try to figure it out, it's easy. If you just like say it out loud, it's obvious. It's the Holy Spirit going through everybody, making us all stand erect and do the same thing at the same time.
You can't explain which way it goes.
Oh, and that makes sense.
And it's going
the spirit
through,
is going through the boards.
And it's
right.
Going through boards, ets,
which are
trees, man,
the people.
Yes. Yes.
That fits.
We're the trees, we're the wood, and the Spirit of God goes all the way through.
Yeah,
now, there's also four on the outside that are shorter, but there's one that goes all the way through. The bars are always the same thing. If you look on your sheet, number 6, I have bars. And then number
14.
I'm sorry, the bars and the poles are the same thing. Number 10, it has the poles of the Ark of the Covenant, same thing. Number 14 is the table of bread, its poles, same verses. The altar of incense has poles, number 22, same verses.
Yeah.
Number 28, the poles of the altar of burnt offering, same thing. And I think that's it. Yeah. So all the poles and all the bars are all the same thing. They're all the same picture. They're the Holy Spirit that connects everything. There has to be the Spirit connecting everything.
Holds it all together.
I'm going to show you what I mean. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 1. As I looked at the living beings, the chayot, now pay attention here, because it's hard to follow unless you're really paying attention. I looked at the chayot, there was one wheel on the earth beside each chayot, for each of the four of them. The appearance of the wheels and their workmanship was like sparkling beryl, and all four of them had the same form. Their appearance and workmanship, as if one wheel was inside another wheel. Whenever they moved in any of their four directions without turning as they went. So it's not like we're gonna go this way, and now we're gonna go this way. It's not like that. It's like this. We're gonna go this way, and now we're gonna go this way. But they don't turn their bodies.
Right.
They just stay like this. Well, how's that possible unless you have one creature that is facing this way and this way at the same time? And that's exactly what it was. So there's something making them move together. It's the Spirit. And it's going through them. What is it? How does it describe the thing that's going through them? How does it describe it? As a what?
As a wheel inside of a wheel.
Right, a wheel. A wheel inside of a wheel. Next to each chaya, next to each living thing, there's a big giant wheel inside of a wheel. And so the wheel is moving with them wherever they go.
Right.
It's moving with them. Wherever that wheel goes, they go. Wherever they go, that wheel goes. And it's holding them together. It's pinning them together so that they're in unity. Verse 18, as for their rims, the rims of the wheels, they were huge, they were scary. The rims of all four of them were full of eyes. So wherever the Spirit of God wants to go, wherever it sees, that's where this conglomeration of stuff goes. Make sense? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah.
Is that clear?
Not at all.
Well, I mean, can you picture it? You can sort of start to picture it? No?
Yes. Somewhat.
Okay. Look at verse 20. Wherever the Spirit was about to go, now we're told.
Right.
Now we're just told right out.
It's the Spirit.
Wherever the Spirit was about to go, they would go in that direction. What was the mechanism to get them moving together?
The wheels.
The wheels. What was the direction of where they were going to go?
The Spirit.
The Spirit.
The Spirit.
Wherever the Spirit was about to go, that's where they would go, in that direction. And the wheels rose close beside them. For the Spirit of the Chayot was inside the wheels. So there's something inside the Mishkan, inside the boards, all throughout the boards that makes them all stand up next to each other, and they all get up and they move together. Make sense?
Yeah, it's the same picture.
Whenever these went, those went. Whenever those stood still, these stood still. Whenever these rose, the wheels rose. For the Spirit of the living beings was in the wheels.
Was in the wheels.
So it's the unifying direction of the Holy Spirit that is pictured by bars. You want to see what the Holy Spirit's direction looks like? It's a bar. Now, don't picture, when we get to the poles, don't picture a little bar like that.
Mic stand.
Don't picture this mic stand. This is about how big the bars were that went through the tabernacle. It's pretty small, about like that. And the ones on the outside. But when we get to the poles, we're talking about a handbreadth thick. We're talking about this. They're huge. And all they do is carry stuff. Yes?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
It's a weird one.
Well, give it a shot.
So, let's say I'm playing drums, worshiping with the sticks, and people actually begin opening their mouths.
Okay, you're playing drums, you're worshiping the sticks, and people start worshiping.
And then I get hit when they weren't singing. When they weren't worshiping, it was just like playing. But when they started, all the people started, something extended.
Yes, that's exactly how it works. People start worshiping, and musicians go along with that direction of the Holy Spirit. That's exactly how it works. That's why I hate and love leading worship. Because I'm playing, but there's nothing happening with the rest of the boards. And then once that pin goes through all the boards,
yeah,
I get hooked up, right, and we're all together.
Yeah, that's
exactly how it works.
Sure.
Exactly how it works. And it's gotta be the Ruach, the Spirit, that drives us together. And I mean drive. Okay. Colossians 1:17. So it's the bar that is pinning together. It's the bar that's pinning together the tabernacle. And it holds it together on the outside with those four bars. So the Holy Spirit is like a binding, unifying force. And that's what we're going to see here. It holds everything together. What did I say, Colossians?
1:17.
Colossians 1:17. I need somebody to call out verses to me so I can find them. Colossians 1:17. He is before all things, and in him all things, what does it say?
Consist of.
Hold together. In him all things bind or hold together. Got it?
Yeah.
That's the bars. That's the bars that hold the whole thing together. It's the Holy Spirit. But here it's describing Yeshua.
Mm-hmm.
So how can it be the Holy Spirit and be Yeshua at the same time?
Yes.
Because Yeshua is called, the Spirit is called the Spirit of Yeshua. The Spirit of the Messiah. All right, chapter 2. Colossians 2, verse 18.
Same book.
Let no one keep, look at this. This is right after the passage about Taviyot. That don't let anybody judge you in regard to food or drink, which is the kosher laws, the new moon, the Sabbath, the festivals. Why? Because they are a shadow. If your Bible says a mere shadow, you should cross it out. It does not exist in the Greek. It does not say mere shadow. It says things which are a shadow of what is to come. But the body belongs to Messiah. In other words, the body casting the shadow is Messiah. Let no one keep defrauding you of your prize. What's our prize? What he just said.
Oh, Judaism.
Yeah, it's the pictures. It's us learning about God through the pictures. Don't let anybody keep trying to take away your prize by delighting in self-abasement and the worship of the angels, taking his stand on visions he's seen and inflated without cause by his fleshy mind, and not holding fast to the head from which the entire body is supplied and, what does it say?
Held together.
By the joints and ligaments, grows with a growth which is from God. In other words, the body, the whole body, is the tabernacle.
Right.
And that spirit, that bar, shoots through it to hold it together. And you got the bars on the outside, the four bars on the outside, holding that whole thing together. That's Yeshua. That's Yeshua. That's the spirit of Yeshua. So it's God's binding spirit of Messiah. That's the best way I can put it. If you can come up with something better, go for it. But that's what I came up with. God's binding spirit of Messiah. Those are a lot of words. Since we are talking about the Ark of the Covenant, I want to skip down to the Ark of the Covenant, and then we're going to end with this. Number 9, the Ark of the Covenant. Let's go back to Ezekiel chapter 1. For about 2 years, I was obsessed with Ezekiel chapter 1 and the Cherubim. And I designed what I thought was pretty close to the description of the cherubim. There's thousands of them out there. Thousands and thousands of them. But you know what? None of them are Jewish. Not a single one.
Really?
Not even the temple, what's it called? The Temple Institute.
Yeah.
They got their design from Egypt.
What?
And a mixture of Egypt, Assyrian, and Babylonian design. However, I found a book written by a Hasidic rabbi. It was compiled back in the 80s, I think. And it's every single thing that Judaism has to say about the tabernacle and the priest's garments. It is the most weird looking book you have ever seen. The drawings are just weird. They look kind of like this. They're weird. And I remember the very first time I drew a drawing of what I thought the cherubim looked like, I showed it to the guy who taught me, Joe Good, and this is what he said. Oh, that's weird. That's what he said. That's weird. And it kind of discouraged me. So I went back and I studied some more, and 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 it just got weird.
Weird.
Yeah. So hopefully you can start to see this. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 5. Within it, within this the covering, the cloud with the fire and the bright light and the glowing metal in it. Within it were figures resembling, kind of like four living things. And this is what they looked like. They had human form. Their bodies were human. Each of them had four faces and four wings. Four faces and four wings. One facing north, south, east, and west. Their legs were straight and their feet were like calves' hooves. Now, if you look in the picture I did, you can see that the legs are calves' legs, or they're cow legs and cow hooves. And they gleam like burnished bronze, kind of like they're made out of gold.
Kind of like a bear claw tub?
Yeah, kind of like they're made out of gold. Under their wings on their four sides were human hands. As for the faces and wings of the four of them, their wings touched one another. Look at the drawing.
Yeah.
See how the wings are touching? Mm-hmm. They did not turn when they moved. Each went straight forward. So if they're going north, you got faces facing north. Two faces facing north. If they're going south, you got two faces facing south. Going east, going west, doesn't matter. They don't have to turn. They just go like this. We're going this way. Now we're going to go that way. And this one puts his arms down. This one raises his arms. Mm-hmm. And then they're going to go that way. This one drops. This one. So it's a constant raising and lowering of their wings so they can go different directions.
Wow.
As for the form of their faces, each had the face of a man. All four had the face of a lion on the right and the face of a bull on the left. And all four had the face of an eagle. So the face of the man is facing Ezekiel. Where's Ezekiel? North, south, east, or west?
I'd say south.
You don't have to guess. It says it in verse 1. Look at verse 1. It came about 33 and the fifth one went up. I was by the river Chabar, and the heavens were open, and I saw visions of God, and the fifth one went up. Verse 4. I looked, behold, a great storm wind was coming from
the north.
So which direction is Ezekiel?
South.
He's south.
He's facing north.
He's facing north.
Yeah.
He is south. He's facing north. And on the right side is what? On the right side is what face?
A lion.
A lion. On the left side is a bull. And the face of the faces, you know, the face of the cherubim is facing like a human, is facing him south. So what side is the eagle on?
North.
North. North.
Oh my gosh, that's so good.
So, that's what I've drawn here for you. This is the Ark of the Covenant. This is what Ezekiel saw. Only he saw the real thing. Let's go to 1 Chronicles 28. 1 Chronicles 28. 18. I'm going to have to look for it. I got an underline. Verse 18. It's giving an enumeration of all the gold, silver, and bronze that Solomon collected. Sorry, that David collected for the temple that Solomon was going to build. And he saw everything in a picture. David did. And then he says in verse 18, and for the altar of incense, refined gold by weight, and gold for the, what is your say?
The tavnit
of the chariot, the picture, the model,
the form
of the chariot, even the cherubim that spread out their wings and covered the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. You have never seen an accurate Ark of the Covenant, either of us. We've never seen one in pictures, we've never seen one in movies, ever. There's nothing on the internet that's accurate. Nothing. It's never been done. Why? Because nobody goes to the Jews to find out what it looks like. So I got as close as I could. I don't know if this is right, but it's as close as I could get. But I did the research, and I found out that the rings were a hand breadth, bigger than a hand breadth on the inside to hold staves or poles that are a hand breadth thick. That's as big as a steering wheel.